So today we are going to see some of the lab glasswares and equipments. You might have used them already or you might know them, but this video is intended to cross-check whether you can name them properly or not. So let's see them one by one. That will be a quick revision before going to a chemistry lab. I think you can identify that this one is a funnel. And these are nothing but beakers. It could be of any capacity, like this is bigger one, this is a smaller one. You can see it's 100 ml, it's 250 ml. So beaker and funnel. Now in this pic, obviously this is a watch glass wherein you can keep your substance here. And then this is litmus paper, red and blue litmus paper. I hope you remember that whenever you want to cross check whether the solution is acidic or basic, you need to use this litmus paper. If it is an acidic solution and if you add a blue litmus paper to it, blue immediately changes to red and vice versa for a base solution. So these are litmus paper and this is nothing but a filter paper. So filter paper is normally used to filter the solid particle from the solution. So this is again a watch glass, filter paper, pic of our chemistry lab, and this is a pic which I have downloaded. Let's go ahead with it. I hope you understand that in order to heat something, if I put a beaker here wherein I need to heat something, first I have to do this much of the setup. Obviously this one is a burner and we normally call it as a Bunsen burner. Then you have a stand and we call it as a tripod stand, on which we are supposed to keep the substance. Then you have to use a wire mesh. This wire gauge or a mesh could be blank or it could have this kind of coating. You can see this coating. This coating is nothing but is of ceramic. So a ceramic coating is done on that wire mesh in order to dissipate the energy equally. So if a flat bottom thing you are going to use, this ceramic is going to divert the heat uniformly to the substance. And secondly, your substance does not get heated up directly. And then here a black soot particle does not get deposited. So we have to select the wire gauge accordingly. Tripod stand, wire gauge, Bunsen burner. Now this one is very easy to identify. I hope you understand that this one is a test tube, right? This is a test tube holder or a stand, you can say. In the test tube, if you can see this one is a boiling tube. Wherein, if you can make out the difference, here the diameter is like less. While this is having a wide mouth, this is broader. So sometimes when I want to keep a substance and I need to heat it on the burner, then we normally use a boiling tube. So that the volume also is increased, because in a test tube the volume is very less. So if I want to heat it, I'll always use a boiling tube. This one is nothing but a thermometer. This is very easy to recognize. Now here there are two things. First one is this and this. I hope you remember. Like what? It's a China dish, right? It's a China dish wherein you can keep your substance and then you can dissolve it in some solvent and then you can heat it. And these are nothing but silica ball, which in terms you can call it as a crucible. So made up of silica ball, these are nothing but a crucible for heating a particular substance. So like if I am taking a substance here, I can take the crucible and I can heat it in the oven or a muffle furnace. So if I have to increase the temperature to 600, 700, I have to heat this substance. So I cannot use a China dish and heat it on a Bunsen burner. Rather than, I can anytime use a crucible, it's made up of silica, and then you can heat it in an oven or a muffle furnace. This has already been covered. It's nothing but a test tube. Now with related to that test tube, I hope you understand that this is the portion wherein you can keep your test tube. So this is nothing but a test tube holder, This is the switch. You can take it this way and this will become tight, and if you take it back it will become loose. So this is how it holds a test tube, and it is a test tube holder. Now here, if you can see, litmus papers strips are being kept, and at the same time these are nothing but some pieces. You can call them as a porcelain piece or a tile piece basically, but this is used in a solution when the solution you are heating, and like if you have a round bottom flask or something and then you are supposed to heat it from the bottom, the solution may get bump. To avoid that bumping, we place a heavy this kind of porcelain piece so that the bumping does not take place. At the same time, if you want to heat some solid substance, you can put it on the porcelain piece and heat it directly in the Bunsen burner. So it is normally used to check whether the compound is giving sooty flame or non-sooty flame, whether it is aromatic or non-aromatic. So a test can be done to directly heat the compound, and for that we use this piece. Now the tray in which it is kept, it is known as Petri dish. Yes, you guessed it right, it is a Petri dish wherein you can keep the compound. You can dissolve it in the solvent. It is used in biology lab as well, used for recrystallization, etc., etc. Yes, with respect to that, I said when you have to keep a porcelain piece, you need to obviously use these tongs in order to keep that, hold that porcelain piece. So these are nothing but tongs. These are basically reagent bottles in which you can keep any kind of reagent. You can see different knobs are there, ultimately different shapes are there, but the basic aim is to store the reagents. Now this one is a wash bottle. In our lab we have two different kind of wash bottles, this one and this one. Herein distilled water is normally stored, and then you can have a normal water too. So whenever you need to rinse anything, whenever you need to wash the burettes, pipettes or the glasswares, you can anytime use the wash bottle to do so. Now you guessed it right, yes, it is a glass rod made up of glass. When I need to stir something or solution, I have some solution in the beaker, it is there, I need to stir it. So I have to put a glass rod inside it in order to stir it. So these are nothing but picks of any kind of glass rod available. This is very similar. You might have used it many a times and you might be knowing it. Just to revise it, this is a burette and this is a burette stand. Here, after finishing your work, you just have to keep it like this so that it dries up easily. And if you can see, some burettes come with this knob wherein switch on and off button is this, while herein it could be a rotating button. So you just have to simply move it clockwise or anti-clockwise, right, in order to close it or open it accordingly. Then here if you can see, it's a knob in order to tighten this particular portion and to fit on that burette, while here there is a portion, this one, wherein if you push it backward it will go back and it will create a space wherein you can take it out the burette. You can take it out from here, this side it is open, so as you push it back you can take it out your burette. So different type of burette stands are possible. And then here it is black, so when you are supposed to keep your compound, you need to use a transparent paper before it in order to see the color change properly. In our lab it is already white in color, so you can simply see the color change. Now this is nothing but a conical flask, and this is a funnel. Funnel could be of plastic or could be of glass, depending on the solution we can select the funnel. Conical flask, I think you know that in order to pursue a titration, we normally does not prefer beaker to titrate. We prefer conical flask. We take the solution in the conical flask and then from top we can use a burette from which we can pour the solution. Can you like think why? Yeah, obviously because it is having a very narrow mouth here, while the beaker is having a very wide mouth. So if you remember, in titration you need to continuously stir the solution. So when you continuously stir the solution, and if the mouth is narrow, the solution is not going to bump out. While here it is quite possible that the solution is going to bump out. So in order to pursue a titration in a very proper manner, we normally select a conical flask. Going ahead with it, as you can see that the measurements are written here. So obviously it is a measuring cylinder. Measuring cylinder name itself suggests that it is used to measure the solution. So here if you can see 250 ml, right, 100 ml, 10 ml, this is of plastic, this is of glass. So measuring cylinders are also available in the lab. Whenever you have to measure certain quantity, you can use them for the measuring the solution. Now this one is known as volumetric flask. Volumetric flask. Volumetric is related with volume. As you can see here, it's 50 ml, it is 100 ml, this is 1 liter, right? So here if you can see, a solution is prepared, right? What you have to do, let's say if you have to prepare one normal solution, so number of gram equivalents dissolved per liter. Let's say you have to prepare one normal NaOH, so for that you have to take 40 grams in 1 liter. So let's say how to make that 1 liter solution. If you can simply focus here, you can see this mark. Similarly, if you can come here and if you can see the mark, this is the mark I'm talking about, right? So this is the mark of graduation. What you have to do, you have to keep your solid compound here and then keep on adding the solvent from the top, keep on adding the water from the top, let it dissolve and keep on adding the water till the water comes at this place. So up to the mark, this solution needs to be filled. And when it is prepared, we'll call it as a one normal solution. So a graduation mark would be seen in every kind of measuring cylinder, and this is used for making authentic and accurate solutions. Now this is very easy. It's a pipette. This is a pipette. While using butyrate in the conical flask, you have to measure the solution using a pipette. Now normally in earlier days, we used to suck the solution, and from here you need to, you know, use your mouth to suck the solution inside. But right now there are options. Like this is a pipette bulb. So this can be used, a rubber bulb is there which can be used. So if you obviously simply if you push it from both of the sides, and then if you lose it, obviously it will create a suction and the solution gets sucked in. Similarly, you can use this kind of thing. This is known as pipette filler or a pipette pump. So a pump or a bulb can be used. Now here if you can see, this is the rolling function of a pump. If you roll it like this, if you keep on rolling like this, it will create a suction here. You have to add your pipette, so it will create a suction here and the solution gets sucked in. Now to release the solution, obviously you have to go the another way. You just have to rotate it this manner and then it will release the solution. If you want to do it fast, you can use this kind of knob. So simply press it and the solution will be released, and in the lab session we'll show you how it work. Basically this is nothing but a reagent bottle, I mean the sample bottle, wherein I just wanted to show that it contains the name, the formula, the product code, the molecular weight and minimum melting point and different constituents. So before taking any substance for the testing, you just have to cross check these things. Do read these things before using it. Yes, these are nothing but spatula. You cannot call it as a spoon, right? You know, cannot call it as a spoon, though it works like that only. To take particular substance from one place to another, we use a spoon, and that's how they are of different sizes. But we call them as spatula. Now if you can see this kind of tube, it is a miniature version of test tube, right? It is known as ignition tube. When I say miniature version of test tube, so in both ways, in terms of length, you can see here, and in terms of this diameter also. So it's very, very narrow mouth and it's very small in nature. You can see a tongue here. The tongue is basically holding this ignition tube, and this is Bunsen burner. You are supposed to heat the compound, and normally it is used when we prepare Lesane's solution for detection of nitrogen, sulfur or halogen in a compound. We first have to take a sodium piece along with the sample, and then we have to fuse them together. So to do the fusion, this kind of fusion tube or ignition tube is used. Similarly, to take out the melting point or boiling point, these kind of tubes are used, which are known as capillary tubes. Capillary tubes are obviously long, you can see, but they are very, very narrow mouth, narrow than that of ignition tube. So you simply have to seal it from one side, and then from other side, you can take your compound inside it, and then you can put the capillary in the melting and boiling point apparatus. And then you can observe when it is melting and just note the melting point. These are nothing but Erlenmeyer flasks, but you call them as iodine flask too, just because they were used in the preparation of iodine. These type of flasks, they are quite flat bottom. So whenever on a hot plate we need to continuously heat it for some time, we use this kind of flasks wherein we can put the solution and then we can use it. This is nothing but a water condenser. Herein you can join it to maybe any flask wherein you're just heating the flask. So the water gets evaporated and it goes up, right? But now what happens is, if I want to heat it for around 2 hours, the volume may get reduced. But I don't want the volume of the solution to get reduced. What I can do is, I can add a condenser. This is water in, this is water out. Now if you can see inside, this particular steam will go. But just because outside here and here, water is flowing. Water is coming inside, right? And then water is flowing up. So water is taking away the heat from it. So this portion inside the tube becomes comparatively cool. So as soon as any vapor go up, just because this area is quite cool, it goes down back. And it further condenses back. This way you can continue heating for long and the volume does not get reduced. So this is condenser, wherein the water is used as a coolant. Water in, water out. This is nothing but a heating mantle. When you are going to heat anything, heating mantle can also be used. Like if you can see here, like it looks like this, wherein you have a temperature knob. You have a LED light which lights up when it is working, and it is a kind of mesh. It could be of aluminium, it could be of fabric. Basically a round bottom flask, when you have to keep that, you can keep it inside so that from every side it is uniformly heated properly. Now in order to continue the same, like if it is not round bottom, what if it is a flat bottom? And I don't want to heat it on a Bunsen burner. I want to increase the temperature more than that of burner. What I'll do is, I'll take these hot plates into use. These could be of many types. Like here you can see a circular hot plate is there. I can keep the beaker here. Same, it is also having a light. It is also having a temperature control and all. And same like that. So what are they call it as? You can call them as hot plates. Now these are reagent bottles, but you call them as brown bottles, especially brown reagents bottle. I hope you do remember there are certain compounds which, you know, react with UV light. So if UV light falls on them, they react, they release some gases, they decompose. So if you want to safely store those substances, you need to take a brown bottle which you know, converts that light into heat. So it's just convert that UV radiation into a lighter energy radiation, IR, so that the compound does not get decomposed. Sometimes the compound get oxidized. So oxidation also can be prevented. Or any kind of photocatalytic reaction is there, decomposition is there, that can also be prevented. So in short, when the compound is sensitive to atmosphere or temperature or heat, you store them in a brown bottle. This is what we were talking about since long. As you can see the bottom, you can call it as a round bottom flask. So normally when condenser is used, we heat it in the round bottom flask and here we join the condenser. And that's it. So today I have just shown you some of the pics of the apparatuses or glassware or consumables which you use it in your daily life in the chemistry lab, but you might not remember the proper name. So I think this video was of good help to you. Thank you.